is ever going to live there. A few years later, Civil War. During and after the Civil War, there's a great number of people who decide they want to go live in the West. Gold is discovered in Montana. Gold is discovered in Colorado. Okay, these all void the existing treaties, right? People start traveling up the Bozeman Trail to Montana. A clear violation of the Treaty of 1851. Army will build Fort Kearney along the Bozeman Trail. Okay, a violation of the Treaty of 1851, right? This will result in what's called Red Cloud's War in 1868. Lakota will make war on the federal government. And they will succeed. They will win. They will get Fort Kearney closed down, and they will chase the U.S. Army out of there. And as a result, the federal government will sign the Treaty of 1868, which they will get access to have people travel up the Bozeman Trail, but reaffirm the Treaty of 1851. A couple years later, a guy named Custer leads an expedition through the Black Hills, and he finds gold. Starts a new gold rush on Lakota land from the Treaty of 1851 in the Black Hills and Deadwood and all that, right? So this goes on. That will culminate in Little Bighorn. Okay? This just keeps going. The federal government has divided up this land, Article 6, these treaties and law of land, right? Supposedly. Okay? They're not going to be abided by. That's clear to everybody at this point. Okay? So clear that in 1871, as a writer to an appropriations bill, the United States Congress will pass what's called the end of treaties. So the Congress will decide we're not going to deal with Indians via treaty anymore. We're simply going to deal with them via legislation. So there's not going to be any more negotiating with Indians. Right? I mean, those negotiations were never very fair. One side was much more powerful than the other, but the Indians always had the right to say no. Indians have now, as of 1871, lose the right to say no to anything. They will simply be dictated to. Okay? This coincides at the same time with what's generally called forced acculturation. So George Washington had the policy of acculturation. He was inviting Indians in to become Americans. Okay? This is an invitation. This is just brute force. This is going to go from the late 1860s into the 1980s. It's not ancient history, right? So, what's going to happen here ranges from the absurd to the tragic. Some of the absurd things, at one point, Teddy Roosevelt administration will decide that there should be a limit to how long Indians' hair can be. And they will send federal bureaucrats running around the country with rulers cutting people's hair. Right? I mean, it's just absurd. Right? But it's part of this forced acculturation. Right? Hair can't be more than 6 inches or whatever it was. Right? And they will go around forcing, they'll have bureaucrats with guns cutting people's hair. Right? The tragic side runs to the boarding schools. Okay? Starting in the late 1860s into the 1880s, what's going to happen is the government will decide the best way to make Indians into Americans is to seize their children when they're 4 or 5 or 6 years old and take them away, hundreds of thousands of miles away from school, and put them in regimented dormitories and teach them to be Americans. So this doesn't end up teaching these people to be Americans. What it does end up doing is creating generations of dysfunctional people. Okay? People who grow up without parents, without love, without compassion, without care. Right? It's the stuff of Pol Pot, right? I mean, who in here has children or grandchildren? Right? I bet most of you do, right? You know, imagine the government comes to you when your children are 4 or 5 or 6 years old and takes your children away and you don't see or communicate with them until the government returns them to you as teenagers. Right? We don't know exactly how many children went to boarding schools. We know it was six figures. It was a lot. It was not a small number, right? So the point to this is once they deviated from the Constitution after the Worcester decision, right? There's no longer a framework here for dealing with Indians. There's no longer the idea of Article 1 and the Indians get to make their own decisions, right? There's no longer Article 6 and the treaties to be upheld. There's just one series of bad ideas by a politician or bureaucrat or social scientist after another, okay? Starting about 1890, there will be forced adoptions, and there will be, especially in Arizona, Utah, Wyoming, Montana, state judges who believe that any Indian child is better off being raised by a white family than their own parents. And they will seize Indian children as property of the state and place them in white homes, right? And again, we don't know exactly how many, but we know the number was six figures. It's not an insignificant number here that this happened. And this will go on and on. There's the other aspect here, which is the legislative part of forced acculturation, in that in 1888, Congress will pass the Dawes Act. So I'm sure most of you in here at some point in your life have heard an Indian say, "You stole our land," right? And maybe you thought they were talking about Christopher Columbus or something like that. But what they're actually talking about is the Dawes Act, okay? The idea behind the Dawes Act was because on these treaty lands, the Indians held their land in common. It was not deeded. So for example, as a Cherokee, right? We own the improvements to our land. If you built a house, that was your house. If you had a barn, that was your barn. If you had 40 acres of carrots, those were your 40 acres of carrots. But nobody owned the land underneath. You only owned improvements to land, was the idea. Well, government thought every Indian should have a deeded plot of land, which, you know, may not sound too terrible as far as that goes. But here's what they did, two things. Any unallotted land, the government seized back, even though it was given to them by treaty, all right? But the really terrible part was this. Anybody that in government deemed to be one half Indian or more by blood was assigned a guardian. And the guardian was responsible for disposing of the Indian's property. The Indian had no say over their own property. And there were, again, we don't know how many. We know it was at least somewhere in the six figures of Indians who lost their land through this, because here's what would happen. The guardian would say the Indian's land was worth $1,000. The guardian would sell it to his buddy for $10. His buddy would sell it for $1,000. The buddy and the guardian would split the $1,000, and the Indian got $10. That happened. We don't know how many times. Hundreds of thousands, though. Right? It led to a great deal of impoverishment of Indians. They had nothing, right? It also introduced into Indians the idea of blood quantum, that you could be half Indian, right? So in Cherokee, that concept doesn't exist. You're Cherokee, you're not Cherokee. That's true of all the Indian nations. There's no such thing as being, you know, half Cheyenne, right? It doesn't exist, right? You are, you aren't, right? And the government now introduces here the blood quantum idea, right? None of which is remotely close to accurate, right? You have bureaucrats going, "How Cherokee are you?" "All of me." And the guy, bureaucrat, look, you look a quarter, you look 5/8. I mean, this is how this is done, right? And this is a legal fate for these people's lives based on what some bureaucrat believes sitting across the table. They'll pass in 1894 the Curtis Act. And the intent of the Curtis Act is to abolish the Indian nations and abolish the Indians as a legal status. Congress reaches the point once they've assigned land that they're done with Indians. They'll just get rid of them, right? Can't have an Indian problem if we don't have any Indians, right? Okay? And that's what they're gonna do. They're just gonna legislate the idea of Indian out of existence. And that's what the Curtis Act is, and it's set to go into effect in 1907, concurrent with the day Oklahoma becomes a state, okay? So, gonna dissolve all the Indian governments, gonna dissolve the legal status of Indian, right? These people just like they never existed. So there's a hitch here shortly before it takes effect that will become what's called the Burke Act, in that there's mining companies, pipeline companies, railroad companies, oil companies who decide, you know what, we don't want to go negotiate for rights, mineral rights, rights away, that sort of stuff, with a gazillion Indians who are not probably not going to be in the mood to negotiate. Right? Okay? So what they do is they pass the Burke Act. And the Burke Act keeps the framework of Indian nations alive and the framework of a government alive. But the government would consist solely of a person the President of the United States appoints to negotiate on behalf of the Indians. These government will not come up from the people anymore, these Indian nations. It's whoever the President is decides to appoint them, and they're not an ongoing thing. The President will appoint them to do something, specifically sign a piece of paper, be that with the federal government or with a railroad company, and the next day there's no more government, right? So imagine that, right? You're selling your house. You could appoint who's going to negotiate for the seller, right? It's quite an advantage, but this is what happened. And that remained that way from 1907 until, for the five tribes, until 1971, and for all the other nations until 1975. So every decision made between 1907 and 1975 didn't actually come from the people it was affecting. It was just whomever the White House appointed to make that decision on their behalf. Okay? That's an important point to note. So you think, okay, this is pretty bad, right? But it's going to get worse because they're going to get rid of the Indian governments in 1907. So for the Cherokee, right, they're going to take all of our infrastructure and they're going to give it back to, or give it to the state of Oklahoma, which is brand new. So we had the very first women's college built west of Mississippi was a Cherokee college. Second college ever built west of Mississippi was a Cherokee college. First telephone system west of St. Louis was on the Cherokee Nation, right? Our cities had gas lighting and sewage systems and running water and electricity by the 1880s and 1890s. The federal government's going to give all of that to the state of Oklahoma. Okay, we don't exist anymore. We don't have colleges anymore. We don't have school districts anymore. We don't have, you know, anything, right? There are going to be laws against, even though people like us, the Cherokee, had a thriving professional class of doctors and lawyers, there's going to be laws prohibiting Indians from practicing as doctors and lawyers, right? So all these things combined are going to start throwing Indians into ever greater poverty, okay? There's very little reason to go to college, because if you get a degree, you can't do anything with it, right? This becomes, you know, the early 20th century, what life looks like for Indians. And you can't organize a government and you have no rights. So you think things can't get worse, but they will. In 1916, there'll be a court case, the United States will be nice. And what's gonna happen? Your nice is, well, here's the gist of the case. It is a federal crime for an Indian to consume alcohol. An Indian will get arrested for consuming alcohol on tribal land. Federal felony. He will have a wonderful constitutional defense, and that he will say that as an Indian on tribal land, under Article 1 or Article 6, you cannot regulate my activities. And he was an American citizen. They had given different Indian citizenship at different times. Because as an American citizen, you cannot regulate my consumption of alcohol. Right? Okay, so wonderful constitutional defense. Well, what's going to happen here in order to convict him, this particular federal judge is going to create a brand new legal status for all Indians. He's going to determine Indians are wards of the state to be emancipated when, if, and to what degree the federal government decides. So this is officially serfdom. Indians are now officially children, and the government is the parent. That is now the de facto legal status. So to combat this, Indians push for citizenship. In 1924, we all become citizens. We think with that will come equal rights, and that's not going to happen. What's going to happen is the court's going to rule, now all these other things still apply to you, even though you're citizens. But Congress is going to go, you're citizens now. Even though the Constitution says Indians can't be taxed, we're not going to tax you. Right? So not only not get the rights, we now have to pay taxes. So things keep getting worse for Indians, and FDR and Hitler will come to power nearly the same time, 1933. And the New Dealers in the Roosevelt administration are going to be pretty critical of how the Nazis treat Jews. Remember, this is 1933, not 1943, right? There's no Auschwitz, that stuff yet, right? The Nazis are going to fire back that Jews in Germany have more rights than Indians in the United States have. And the argument's going to get international traction because it's true. Okay? This embarrasses the New Dealers, and the New Dealers are then going to go try and do something about it, but what they do is the classic kind of New Deal thing. They're going to pass the 1934 Indian Reorganization Act and 1936 Oklahoma Indian Welfare Act. And what they're going to do, remember, these people are being appointed by the president negotiating on behalf of the Indian nations, right? Okay? They're going to have the Indian nations sign over their sovereignty to the federal government. And the federal government is going to require the Indian nations to reorganize as corporations. That's why you'll see most often titles like chairman or whoever's in charge of an Indian nation, because they are reorganized as a corporation, not as a government. So there's not very many tribes who aren't going to do this. The Osage won't, and the Cherokee won't. Cherokee Nation will not. Okay, this is going to matter a lot later. So you're now reorganized as a corporation, and the board of directors for your corporation is the Bureau of Indian Affairs. You are now completely within the clutches of the government. Okay, each, and this is important to understand, there's 567 nations federally recognized today. Each one has a different legal agreement. And part of that is case law, part of that is treaty, but most of that is what the specific board of directors from the BIA for that nation allows them to do and not do. They are at the mercy of the federal government entirely. This is why today you have Indian nations where Indians can have a job without federal permission. You can't start a business without federal permission. Okay, you have to live where the federal government tells you to live. It's why you go to some tribal lands today and you'll see 70, 80, 90% unemployment rates. Okay? And if you're lucky enough to get a job, federal government is lucky enough to grant you the right to work someplace, and they say, you can work here. And you'll have a minimum wage job over here, and the federal government goes, well, we're also responsible for your housing. You're going to live in a house over here 40 miles away from a part-time minimum wage job. And you're going to show up at a two-bedroom house and find out there's already six people living there. I mean, these things are everyday occurrences in how it works, right? You can't start a business. It's virtually impossible. You have to apply for federal permission to start a business. And it takes you years. Your market's gone by the time the federal government gets around to granting you permission, right? All these things come about because of the Indian Reorganization Act and Oklahoma Indian Welfare Act. So you think, okay, that can't get much worse, right? But it does. Despite all the federal help that the New Dealers are giving them, things get worse for Indians. Until 10 years after that, 1944, remember, height of World War II, right? We're invade Normandy that year. We invade the Philippines that year, right? I think Congress would be focused on World War II. But things have gotten so bad for Indians. In 1944, Congress is going to hold joint hearings on the condition of Indians. And it's remarkable because a Democrat Senate and a Democrat House are going to find a Democrat president, Franklin Roosevelt, too inept and incompetent to execute the law as written. Right? It's an astounding thing. It really is. Right? You think they would do something rational about that, right? Well, they don't, because when the person they appointed to sign over their ability to take your sovereignty, right? That part of that deal was they agreed that the federal government could terminate those Indian nations. And that's what the federal government's gonna start doing in 1945. Rather than fixing the problem, they're just gonna start ending Indian nations. So from 1945 to 1969, they're gonna end 109 Indian nations. Just terminate them. You don't exist anymore. Boom, boom, boom. Just methodically about one a quarter for 25 years. That's why there's 567 now instead of 676 that there were in 1944. So this is all going to continue like this until 1969. In 1969, Richard Nixon is going to become president. Let your heads kind of explode here. The only president who ever tangibly did anything to help Indians in this country since Andrew Jackson came into office was Richard Nixon. Richard Nixon, 1969, has got an end termination. 1969, they're going to pass the Indian Child Welfare Act, which will force an end to, bring an end to the forced adoptions. Right? Takes the custody of these children, responsibility of the Indian nation, not state courts of Indian children. Okay? Sometimes you will see on the news where an Indian child was given to a foster family that was not Indian, and they will be removed from that and given to an Indian family, and they make a big deal out of, you know. This is why. This is why that law exists, so that we don't have forced adoptions anymore. Okay. 1971, Nixon will return to the five tribes the right to select our political leadership. No longer have a chief appointed for a day to sign a document. So the Cherokee, Chickasaw, Seminole Creek, Choctaw. We'll get to choose our own chiefs again. 1975, they're going to extend that out to all the other Indian nations as well. You will get to choose your own leadership again. It's not appointed by the president, right? The other big thing that's going to happen in the 1970s, and not a whole lot's happened since the 1970s that's good. The five tribes will sue the federal government in a case called Harjo v. Hutt. And we will sue the United States federal government. We will accuse them of bureaucratic imperialism. That's the basis of the lawsuit. And we will sue and we will win. And for the Cherokee Nation, what that means is, in that court decision, the judge will say the Cherokee Nation is inherently sovereign. We never ceded our sovereignty, and our sovereignty precedes that, predates that of the United States. So, we will win back, as Cherokee, our sovereignty in the 1970s. We are the only tribe, the only nation with that level of sovereignty. And we can tell the federal government to go pound sand, and we do. And there's nothing they can really do about it. State of Oklahoma can't make us do anything. The federal government can't make us do anything. They can pay us. If they pay us enough, we'll do it. But they can't make us do something. Right? So, I think I went a little over my time. So where does this all take us? Right? To point Sean made. Right? What I just detailed out, once we left the Constitution, we had a path. Up until Andrew Jackson, where people could live together without having to be at war or without having to utterly submit one side to the other. That was the idea George Washington originally had. Okay? That was what Andrew Jackson slammed the door on. And Andrew Jackson slammed the door on that by voiding the Constitution. And once they voided the Constitution, it's just been one bad idea after another, after another, after another. Whatever some politician, some bureaucrat, some social scientist thought, hey, let's do this, is what happened. Okay? It devastated millions of lives. It left large swaths of people in utter poverty. It has created a situation where most of you in this room take certain freedoms for granted, like you can go get a job without government permission, or you can start a business without government permission, or you can live where you want. And now we have people in these various tribal lands who don't have that freedom. I mean, this is where all this not following the rule book has taken us. Right? It's, I'm afraid, what's happened to Indians is what's happening now to everybody, right? You know, and that's really the lesson in this, right? So let me ask you. The solution to this is to go back to the Constitution. The solution to this for Indians is Article 1 and Article 6, right? Return the sovereignty to the Indian nations and fulfill the treaties, and it's not nearly as hard as those detractors from that one claim it is. Right? It's very much the situation the Cherokee Nation lives under today. Right? We made it work, everybody can make it work. Okay? But for all of you, right, this casual bleeding out of your constitutional rights isn't gonna work. It will not end in happiness and prosperity. All right? But I really hope you start with the Indians. give Indians back Article 6. All right? There's legislation. Congressman Cole and Mullins are the only two Indians in Congress, and they have legislation they are working on to restore Article 1 sovereignty to the tribes. I would ask you if you contact your congressmen or senators, Mr. Gardner, to go over and talk to those fellows and say, how can I help you do this? Right? Scott Tipton, all these people, how can, go talk to Mullins and Cole and say, how can we help with this? Other than that, Wajo, thank you for your time. Thank you guys for all coming out. Thanks, Susan, for inviting us here and feeding us and all this other stuff. So, thank you.